Eccentric and outrageous are perhaps two of the kinder adjectives Mr. Quentin Crisp, my guest this afternoon, has heard used to describe him. Mr. Crisp was the subject of last night's film, The Naked Civil Servant, of which you've just seen an excerpt, based on his memoirs. He was a self-evident homosexual in the early 30s, when, as Mr. Crisp says, other men searched for signs of effeminacy on themselves as if for lice. Mr. Crisp decided to brazen it out, plastering on lipstick, gold eyeshadow and nail polish, and dyeing his hair with henna, adding a touch of colour to the streets of Chelsea. Now, that film last night by Philip Mackay and Jack Gold impressed me no end and moved me. How did it strike you?
Well, I thought that it was quite remarkable. I was asked whether I thought it was like my life, and I said I thought it was better because shorter. And it's also like the book and shorter than that. So it's got the essence of the various things, of the drama and the cruelty and the depravity and the jokes. And in that way, I thought it quite remarkable.
Did people actually attack you physically for just how you looked?
They attacked me physically. They sometimes attacked me without speaking a word to me, just rushed up and hit me. And sometimes they would say various things. Of course, the famous thing that everybody said was, what are you supposed to be? Or are you supposed to be a man or a woman? To which I used to reply, why do you ask? What were you going to suggest we should do?
But why do you think, I mean, what emotion is it in people that wants to attack you for just being something you want to be?
Well, part of it is genuine moral indignation, and for this one has the greatest respect. And I see no reason why people shouldn't morally object. But of course, the English answer won't really do. It's, you can either shoot the homosexuals the moment you know they're homosexual, or you can let them be. You can't take a middle course by chivying at them and making their life difficult. You're not going to get anywhere. They're either going to go under, which makes them more difficult to get to know, more difficult to cope with, or else they're going to brazen it out. If you have a candle burning in a room where there's a draft, it can't burn straight. So that, and this is what happens to a homosexual person, once everything he does, says, is, looks like, is in question. And this was so long before I was ever made up or flamboyant in any way. It was true at home now, and true at school. Now, if this is so, you cannot grow absolutely vertical. You cannot remain absolutely still saying, this is what I am. You start to protest, because after statement comes protest. It's very hard to tell the difference.
Well, then, why did you, though, you see, dress so flamboyantly when a lot of homosexual males, certainly at that time, were remaining incognito?
Well, because you can't remain incognito if it's something which affects other people so deeply. Or as I saw it, I couldn't remain incognito. People said, why do you bother? It's your concern. It's nothing to do with them. Well, with 50 or 60 people walking behind me in the street, you can't say it's nothing to do with them. It's absolutely vital to them. But they were eaten up with it.
Yes, but were you then crusading? Were you saying, I am who I am and I must tell you who I am?
First of all, I was merely being who I was. Then when I found the protests were so strong, that was the time it seemed to me that it was necessary to live out my life. Getting up and going to work and buying my food in the shops and going home again, so that somewhere there would be someone who could be seen on the one hand to be homosexual and on the other hand to be part of life. I would be on a bus and people's reactions were so strong that I used to say to them, if you like, I will get off. But even people like me cannot walk everywhere.
But you see, I'm still a bit puzzled, I suppose, because did you get something of a kick out of it then, that you knew people were going to stare at you?
The kick I got out of it, because the difficulty is, that I know I'm not only speaking to you, I'm speaking to the world. Therefore, I must never say the kick I got out of it was that I felt I was right. I couldn't do otherwise. I never had any feeling of making a choice. Once my existence was in question, I felt it has to be stated. You see, it's very difficult for anyone like yourself who's born into a world where your destiny is already set. This is the way you are. Very difficult for you to understand the situation. I have to ask you to say to yourself, supposing it got round to you that your friends had said, if I'd known she was a girl, I'd never have asked her. I mean, leaving her alone with the children. I mean, someone should have told me. You would then think, this is absurd. I must find a way of letting everyone know I'm a girl. I can't be in this position where they are being friendly to somebody else of the same name, since they don't know who I really am. So you then grow your hair long and wear stockings and a skirt, and everyone can see you're a girl, and then they needn't get mixed up with anything so terrible. So it's the same for me. I couldn't go to people's houses disguised as a human being when I knew perfectly well that if they knew the truth, they would ask me not to come again.
Well, then, you see, you chose to put a lot of makeup on at a time when, if women put a lot of makeup on, they were accused of being tarty. It was even said she is cheapening herself in order to get men.
This was the difficulty. At first, of course, I didn't think about this at all. I just thought, this is the way. Since I can't, when I'm asked how I am, shake hands with people saying, I'm homosexual, how are you? I felt that we must have something whereby they can see it before they ever get here, and they think, well, that's it, now we'll deal with it in our own way. We will either pretend it hasn't happened, remark on it, or sidestep the whole issue by simply not meeting such a person. It's true that, of course, immediately it got to seem that I was wearing the makeup in order to attract men. It wasn't true, because of course no man ever speaks to a person who is made up, a man who is made up in the street. If you're going to have relations with men, you've got at any moment to be passed off as somebody's nephew. I was nobody's nephew.
Now listen then, you describe yourself as an effeminate homosexual. Does that mean you wanted to be a woman?
Originally, yes. I would like to have been a woman. And now that you can have the operation practically on the national health, it would be quite different for me.
Would you have had that operation?
Oh, yes. If you could have waved a wand over my head and turned me into a woman, my whole life would have been self-evident. It would all have been of a piece. This is what Miss Morris says. Nothing would have been in question. I would have been able to walk the way I walk, speak the way I speak, without any remark, whereas I, personally, don't ever remember a time when I wasn't being made fun of. Mm. I now know, of course, that part of this was my special background, family life, environment. I had middle-class, middling parents living in the suburbs, but I assure you that if I had gone like that to describe something I was saying, all my brothers and sisters would have fallen on the floor.
What do you mean, because they, did they know about homosexuality?
No, because it would have been weird, far-fetched, theatrical, ostentatious. They certainly had no idea of what the trouble was one day going to be. And one has to remember that though my parents did lack understanding to an extraordinary extent, they cannot be blamed. They tried to prepare me for the world they knew. So no one ever said, when you go up, you will go out into the world and there you will meet people as mad as yourself, and I can only hope you get on with them. Because they didn't know there were people as mad as I am. They didn't know there was this far-fetched world in which I would actually be able to, not only to get on, but to make a living and to have friends and to appear on television.
But you see, you did set yourself aside in a way because of your looks, I think. didn't you? Mm. And by doing that, I mean, I don't know whether you said it or whether it was said in the film by someone else, that an exhibitionist has no friends.
Well, I didn't ever say it, but now I know that an exhibitionist must be prepared to have no friends. Mm. In fact, I didn't pay the total price. As soon as I saw what the public reaction was, I knew the price was going to be great. I didn't know it was going to be as great as it was. I didn't know there were going to be crowds in the street. But in the end, amazingly enough, I haven't paid the total price. I have not been without work or without friends. And this is a tribute, as I see it, to human nature, that people would undergo the shame.
But if you'd known now what you knew, you know, what happened to you was quite amazingly cruel, would you have still behaved as you did if you'd known it was going to be like that?
Oh yes, I couldn't have done otherwise. Once I'd begun, I couldn't have done otherwise. I couldn't go back and say, there, I didn't really mean it, I'm not as homosexual as all that. I couldn't have brought myself to do. I wanted everyone to get used to the fact. Unlike other people who, at the time, used to say, if only we were being understood, I never expect to be understood, nor care whether I'm understood. The great thing that is on the side of eccentrics, exhibitionists, homosexuals, is boredom. You see, now the fact of someone being homosexual, hardly worth mentioning, and except in some particular context of which you say, well, you haven't understood the situation at all, they are lovers. Then you say, oh, you see. But to be told that somebody in public life is homosexual leaves you saying, and then?
Well, do you think we're getting more adjusted to our sexuality?
Well, I think you're getting adjusted to it, but it would be a mistake for homosexuals to imagine that the change in the law reads, forgive us for having persecuted. Please cross our unworthy threshold with your purple feet. Because the message reads, the place has become a mess. You'll love it.
Going back to your dark, damp prison of eternal love, if it's a prison, who do you think are the prisoners? Do you think mostly women are or mostly men are?
Well, since men don't really, I think, listen while they're saying, with my body, I thee worship, and these other things, I think it's probably the women who, until recently, looked on marriage as something which they must achieve. Not to have got married was to be a failure when I was young. If you were not married and someone, a cashier said, Mrs. or Miss, you said, ha ha, I'm not married, thank God. You don't have to do any of that now. You say, Miss. This is what was the prison, having to get married to show you could. And then you were stuck with it because anything else meant you obviously had failed at something, since you are now alone. Well, as far as I'm concerned, you've got to have at least some time to be alone. I love people, and I spend a great deal of time with them. I know as many people as I can. But I have to be alone sometime. The two things go together. This doesn't mean that I've seen through people or I'm only pretending I like people and really I want to be alone. It doesn't mean any such thing. As I give myself utterly to everybody, all the time, I get exhausted, happily exhausted. And therefore, there are times when I go away and am by myself in order to renew myself. It's like going to your dressing room. You can't be on stage all day of every day, only nearly all day of every day.
When you said you wanted to be a woman, that was my ambition. Now, the funny coincidence about this particular thing, watching that film last night and the way you looked, where your head goes up and so forth, reminded me that I wanted to be a woman like you were. Now, You must have based your woman, I think, on a fantasy.
I think this is so. Nearly all homosexuals of this kind, by the way, first of all, we have to make a public statement, since I'm not only addressing you. Nothing I say must be thought to be typical of homosexuals, because there's no such thing. They're people. So what I say isn't even typical of people. It's just my view. But I think if you're an effeminate homosexual and have at least in the beginning, because it wears off after a while, the world touches you, you know how to get on, you know how to get a job, you know how to form your relationships, and you say, I'm effeminate, but I know I am not a woman, you must take what you're given from me. Then when you do that, you're in the clear. But while you wish you were a woman, you are working away at it. You see, a woman can, if necessary, hammer a nail into a plank of wood. But a homosexual must never do this, because this is the clue. He might just as well be a man. So you sit there, there's the nail, and there's the piece of wood, and you wait.
You did, didn't you, base yourself, though, on a fantasy, like, say, a film star?
Film stars seem in some extraordinary way to have gone out to meet the fantasy. When you give homosexuals the opportunity to dress up, they never dress up like people.
No.
The tarlatan boas and the spun glass hair and heels persecution high are worn. And the strange thing is that even at the time, Miss Garbo and Marlene Dietrich never looked like women. This is absolute nonsense. And now, the drag acts still do it.
Yes, that's right. I've noticed this.
Now, I have not seen a woman go like this in the last 25 years. And if I did, I would think either it's a man in drag or it's a woman who hasn't been happy since 1926.
But you see, this is exactly what I was coming to, is that my idea when I was younger, that I wanted to be that sort of woman. I wanted to capture...
A vamp.
A vamp. Exactly the word. And it is only later that I settled down to the idea that I wasn't going to be a vamp of
That's
all
right.
the men in the world.
That's right. Well, this is what I wanted, and what, as far as I know from talking to other effeminate homosexuals, the one who come to see me and say, do you think I would look nice in black, do you think I should do my hair this way or that way? Those all seem to me still to want to be this divine being. And the interesting thing from your point of view is why homosexuals do it, and the interesting thing from my point of view is, where did it come from? Who invented Marlene Dietrich? No one in the world has ever worn a tarlatan boa. Only she.